Good morning, Jags. This is Fahad. Today is Monday, March 1st. Let's get started. Two medtech stocks that have tremendous amount of catalysts coming up have pretty interesting setup in my view here. So I would like to discuss those. And then I may follow up later today or tomorrow and issue a trade alert on these if you do not get them in yourself. Okay, so the first one is Medtronic. Now, this was discussed briefly in chat room on Friday, and this is the discussion on that one. And as you can tell, we pointed out at that time on Friday, February 26th, that this is one of my favorite technical setup for a breakout next week. And we saw somebody with a very short-term bullish bias roll call options by 1 week, rolling out from February 26th weekly 117 strike calls to 118 strike. And this came after Bank of America also last week called this a stock the best near-term setup in years. And then there was a brief note that I provided along with it. And if you go to the option market, you will see that this 3,000 open interest, which is in the March 5th weekly 118 strike calls, this is where that bullish trader rolled the position out to. So this expires on Friday, this Friday. But then separately along with that, if you further look out, you will see 5,000 open interest in the March 120 strike calls. And then you will see much more bullish bias similarly in April, May, and some outer months as well. And if you look at the chart technically, this is a wall of resistance at $120 per share. And another way of looking at this is by simply going to stock charts, and you will see that this has been a remarkable resilient stock during this market correction that we just saw last week. Barely pulled back from 52-week high. The setup continues to be quite strong for a technical breakout. So the key is to see that today, with the equity market futures bouncing back sharply, and interest rates stabilizing, let's see if this thing going to start breakout from 119 to 120. And if it does, I think we see 125 to 130 rather pretty quickly from Medtronic. Now, aside from a couple bullish views that I provided in chat room on Friday, this is the most important thing that you need to keep in mind, the upcoming catalyst, which could potentially result in a breakout in stock. Number one, the earnings are out of the way, right? So first of all, understand that the earnings already came out last week, so you don't need to worry about it. But what's going to happen in the month of March compared to the recent earnings call, Bank of America points out that they are materially more bullish based on the management tone that they provided. And they expect that the channel checks are going to show improving surgical volumes. And the company is intending to provide some data points related to that before the end of the year. Now, this could happen, before the end of the quarter. Now, this could happen with either a earnings pre-announcement for the first quarter before the end of March that could serve as a potential catalyst for the stock, or this could come with their monthly update, just providing some color as to how surgical volumes and hospitals are starting to bounce back as we reopen the economy gradually. Also in the month of March, they're going to announce a CE mark filing with the United States IDE office for their robot, which competes directly with Intuitive Surgical. Now, understand that Intuitive Surgical has a monumental lead on all kinds of robotic surgical instruments. But it has been long coming by competitors to somehow close that gap. I still don't think they'll be able to close the gap. Intuitive Surgical is the absolute leader in the space, but Zimmer has made quite a bit of progress. Johnson & Johnson has been doing some tuck-in acquisitions, and now Medtronic is going to show their CE mark filing, which would be a significant one. If this happens, this could finally start to bring some visibility exactly when this company will be able to start monetizing their robots compared to Intuitive Surgical going forward from here. So that's another catalyst that is expected sometime in March. Then further on in May, they're going to host, this will be their earnings call. And management last week said that they will not provide the guidance for the full year until they have, they're at least one quarter in into this fiscal year. So that means that the next earnings call, which is going to be in May, is going to be the significant one. And considering the economy is reopening, the surgical volumes in hospitals are starting to bounce back, and there's a pent-up demand for that as well. I expect that earnings call, particularly guidance, is going to be very, very strong and robust, and that's a setup for a technical breakout in stock. Then takes you out to June. Two major launches are coming up: the 780G, which is going to compete in the diabetes space, and Zoe's approval, as well as a U.S. launch. All of that is expected in the month of June. When the time gets closer to that, we will cover that in more detail. Then in September and October, we're about to get the European approval for Medtronic's robot, which will compete with Intuitive Surgical. Another major catalyst at that time, September and October, for this particular business, which I believe is not fully baked into consensus view. And then hypertension data, which is coming out in the month of October. So series after series, you've got earnings report, you've got economy improving, you've got surgical volumes bouncing back, you've got plenty of pipeline updates coming up, you've got launches coming up, material launches coming up from diabetes to the robotic surgery and all of that. And so this stock should be in play for several months to come, particularly for the next 2 to 3 quarters. And as a result, I believe the excitement will remain. And technically also, this is showing relative strength. As the market was selling off last week, this was actually attempting to break out. So watch that $120 per share, see if it takes out and makes a new run. Another MedTech stock I want to just briefly discuss real quick, and I will come back to this with more details, is Axonics Modulation, AXNX. Now, previously, last year, as many clients know, twice we issued the official trade alert on this stock to buy call options. Both times it worked out because we were technically savvy about where we wanted to make entries on the chart and where we wanted to take profits. And this is exactly the kind of setup we have once again in AXNX. This is the channel that's in front of you. It's a pretty well-defined channel. And watch, because of the recent market correction, earnings are already out of the way, and the stock has come back to an important bottom of the channel. This $50 level or $49 to $50 level is your support. Friday was a doji candle. If we start to bounce off from here, I see this thing gradually climbing back all the way up to $60 per share. On a percentage basis, that would be about 20% move higher. So a very easy entry. This is also the VOP support level. If you look closely right over here, around $49 to $50 per share, from as much as 20% to the upside. Now, there was interesting and a very important news in this stock last week, fundamentally, that many seems to have skipped. And this is the kind of news, because everybody was worried so much about 1.5% treasury bond yield that that's all everyone's focusing on, while they continue to ignore what's happening in some of these companies. The stock should have bounced sharply on this news, but it did not, because the market was selling off. What was the news? The news was this company announced a tuck-in acquisition. Specifically, they announced that they would be buying a company called Balcamid Contura Limited, I believe it's based in Israel, for $200 million in cash and stock. Plus, they're going to be providing $35 million milestone to this company if it continues to meet the certain clinical milestone in the pipeline. This acquisition was announced on Thursday last week, February 25th. What is this company, this acquisition? This privately held company called Balcamid Contura and its flagship product called Balcamid is the best-in-class urethral bulking agent for women with stressed urinary incontinence. Now, actually, it's based in London. Sorry, I thought it was Israel. And so, in other words, if you look at some of the literature that is coming out, and there has not been a lot of analyst coverage on this one so far, In total today, there are about 150,000 surgeries a year in the U.S. and 25,000 injections that are given every single year to address the need for some 20 million women in the United States alone that suffer from this problem. And this acquisition is specifically targeting that particular industry, and given low penetration in the market and not a lot of choices available right now. You can read about what Balchem it is by simply doing a Google search and going online and finding out exactly how it is different than others. Bank of America did a survey of key opinion leaders late last week. I believe it was done over the weekend, actually, Friday, Saturday, to understand whether this is going to be a game changer for the company. And they came back with very, very positive commentary around this. This panel of key opinion leaders, which was, by the way, and this drug Balchem, it was approved last year by the FDA already. So this is not a risk anymore. They came back with the views that I'm going to quote over here. Saturday's panel on Exonics new bulking agent Balchemic suggests this product, due to its differentiated design, has more durable efficacy based on strong randomized head-to-head data now out 7 years. The procedure takes 10 to 20 minutes in the doctor's office, and the panelists suggested that this product could be a first-round minimally invasive therapy option for nearly all women suffering from SUI. Some women will still prefer surgery, according to our panel, but the perceived risk of surgery due to the litigation over the last 5 years and the appeal of minimally invasive option suggest to us a large multi-hundred-million-dollar opportunity for Exonics modulation after this acquisition. The panelists have seen no issues with migration or retention. Doctors mentioned that you inject significantly less volume with this product. Training is easy on pig bladders and takes 10 to 20 to become fully comfortable. This injection does not limit any options downstream if needed, and the product is well reimbursed, unquote. Long paragraph over there, but it sums it up very nicely how the medical practitioners are taking this product as a minimally invasive product, as a perfectly viable and acceptable form that's going to take a lot of market share away from very costly surgical procedures for women with SUI. And as a result, this stock benefits from this. Now, what does this mean in terms of financial? This is not baked into consensus view. Only one analyst has come out so far. This company is now expected Exonics modulation to see $15 million in revenue upside this year, rising to $35 million next year, and then eventually reaching $300 million in sales by 2023 with an accelerating ramp. This company has a market capitalization of only $2 billion, and this product alone will become a $300 million category. So you can see this is where substantial upside could come from over the course of next 2 years. I expect over time we're going to see more and more analyst upgrades and price target hikes in this stock. Meanwhile, it has pulled back given the market sell-off to an important support level. All right, that's Exonics modulation. That's it from me. Let's go to Jay.
Morning, everyone. So no stock-specific discussion today, but rather an update on Jaguar Media. For those that do not know, in early to mid-January, launched Jaguar Consumer. If you go back to the first video, I essentially talked about how there are many industries one could talk about, or sub-industries one could talk about within the consumer sector. And really since that launch, you know, I've talked about a few restaurant stocks, a few apparel footwear stocks, and then UTZ, which would have been a packaged food company. So I think I have an idea on what, you know, Jaguar Consumer is going to consist of in terms of the type of stock, but I believe there are still industries that I can cover. So with that being said, I plan to launch a new series for Jaguar Media that covers the gaming, lodging, and leisure industries. I believe it's just a natural extension of Jaguar Consumer. So, you know, within gaming, not only would I be taking a look at the major players like a Wynn or a Las Vegas Sands, but also the regional players like Red Rock Resorts or Monarch Casino, or even Churchill Downs, one that often gets overlooked. And we had actually made that a top pick way back when. In the lodging space, yeah, of course, you've got your Hyatt, your Hilton, you know, even something like a Marriott Vacations, VAC. And then on the leisure side of things, this is where you can look at the boating industry, such as Marine Max or Brunswick, then the recreational vehicle market or the cruise lines, for example. So, you know, like I said, this is just going to be a natural extension of the Jaguar Consumer series. But, you know, taking a look more specifically at gaming, lodging, and leisure. Now the team is going to be working on the Q2 outlook, so I wouldn't expect this to launch for another few weeks, but when it does, or when I'm about ready to launch that first episode, I will, you know, either send an email to clients or I will update them in conversations.
Excellent. And you know, this is perfect time for this too. I'll briefly say this, that, you know, I'm in various enclosed, tight chat rooms in, you know, around the internet on my mobile phones and through different apps, where I am closely in touch and I talk with hedge fund managers, guys that runs hundreds and millions and billions of dollars in the market, called big shots all the time, based in Connecticut and whatnot. So, you know, there's a lot of friends I have in the industry, in the finance industry, that I am closely in touch with. And we are, you know, I find myself in different kinds of enclosed chat room with 10 people, 15 people in it. And we openly talk stocks and opportunities in the market. And a lot of the opinions that I form comes from an understanding and a general understanding and, you know, back and forth debates and discussion, which gives me ways to think about a lot of things that we do. These are in closed chat rooms. Nobody can get into them. But I'm telling you all of this is because that recently, just over the weekend, yesterday, in fact, in one of those discussions that I had with a hedge fund was about leisure industry should be making a remarkable comeback with the reopening. And we talked about the U.S. I'm just going to give you some highlights of our discussion back and forth. So, for example, if you, you know, the U.S., you can see these charts if you Google them on the internet, but the U.S. household savings rate is about 21% right now. It's crazy, right? It's ridiculous. Now, to give you some idea how high that is, typically the U.S. household savings rate used to be about 6 to 8% in normal times. And during a recession, people tend to save more. And so if you compare that to prior 2008 recession, you will see that at that time it spiked to about 12%, 13% before it started to normalize and such and such. We're at above 20% right now. Kathy Wood of ARK also talked about this in her video over the weekend. But then you compare high saving rate with the view that the U.S. total net household debt service payment, all kinds of debt, student loans, house, you know, home debt, total debt service payment as a percentage of total household income has shrunk to only 9%. This used to be the general trend, is around 20 to 25%. So the savings rate is very high while the debt service payment is very, very low. So free cash flow position for household is very, very high and strong. But the problem is they are unable to spend that cash anywhere because the economy is still locked down. They can't go anywhere. But we are gradually opening up. And this goes back to my point that I have mentioned many times before on why I'm so bullish on travel sector, where you get to a point in a couple months from now where mobility sharply goes up across the country. People have been locked away. Excuse me. People have been locked away in their homes for more than a year. They want to go out on vacation. They want to fly. They want to hit the beaches. They want to go to bars and nightclubs. You know, what does that do to all kinds of leisure properties, the hotels, the airports? There's going to be a shortage of these properties, in my opinion, in some cases with overshot, like we have chip shortage going on, you know, right now. And that could very well happen by the time the summer months rolls around. That means it's bullish for Macau casinos. That means it's bullish for a lot of hotel operators. We should see RevPAR grow double-digit percentage. It's bullish for many, many stocks within the travel and leisure category that haven't really come to the light yet. These charts are also starting to break out and gradually trending higher, like the Wynn chart that's in front of you. So I think it's prime time to bring that discussion for, you know, in front of everybody anyway.
Absolutely.
Good stuff. Looking forward to this new new series on Jaguar Media. Okay, let's go to Chronicle.
Morning. I have updates on two companies today. First one is Take-Two Interactive, symbol TTWO. This was a Jaguar Media video from February 2nd in which we said we were bearish in the near term but bullish in the long term. So over the weekend, there were palpable rumors which emerged that the upcoming anticipated release of GTA 5 Enhanced on the new consoles is going to be delayed until next year. And the main thrust behind this was that Sony put out a trailer on Saturday featuring some of the most anticipated titles that will be coming out on the PlayStation 5. And what caught the gaming community's attention was the fact that the other games that were featured in the trailer had some sort of release time frame or date that was superimposed onto the footage. But then when it came to GTA 5, it looks like Sony completely left it out. So this prompted a lot of speculation that Take-Two might be delaying the release, which led to questions like, you know, because we've already been told many times to be expecting GTA 5 Enhanced in the second half of this year. So why would Sony decide all of a sudden to not put out a time frame? So this is only a rumor. I wouldn't treat it as actual news, but nevertheless, I think this is an important development to be keeping an eye on, particularly given that Take-Two's management still didn't provide an exact timeline during last month's earnings call, because if GTA 5 Enhanced is in fact delayed, that's going to result in negative revisions to revenue estimates for at least the first three quarters of the fiscal year, because this title was supposed to be the big one for this year for the company. And I think the other important implication here that few seem to be talking about is if GTA 5 Enhanced is getting delayed until next year, then it probably means the timeline for GTA 6 is going to be pushed back even further. And then finally, there is yet another hidden implication here, which is if GTA 5 Enhanced gets delayed, then it could also imply that the testing for the Rage engine, which is what powers GTA 5 and Red Dead Redemption 2, that testing could be facing complications. And that's going to have other negative knock-on effects. So this is something important to watch if you have any interest in the stock. One thing I've noticed is that the entire gaming industry has been littered with production delays recently because of COVID. Because these days, developing a game takes a lot of coordination with all the voice acting, directing, model capture, and testing. So the pandemic has made all of that more difficult now, which is why I've taken a non-consensus view that this year is going to be somewhat of a letdown for the industry in general. Like if we go back and take a look at our current coverage table, you'll notice that I'm not exactly bullish on many gaming companies this year. The only developer that I'm personally long right now is Nihon Falcom, which trades in Tokyo. But that's more of an idiosyncratic story where they've been stepping up the localization of their flagship franchises, and they're beginning to gain a large cult following internationally after many years of their addressable market being only domestic. But coming back to Take-Two and putting everything together, I'm going to take this rumor with a grain of salt, but at the same time, it's not inconceivable that GTA 5 Enhanced gets delayed with all the disruptions from COVID. And if that's the case, then that's going to be another headwind on top of the near-term bear case that we already presented on Jaguar Media recently.
So quick question. Now, first of all, just to remind all the audience over here that on February 2nd, right here, this was a brand new series that we launched called Electronic Gaming Software, in which we presented Take-Two Interactive. But we were very specific about this presentation. And there's a whole slide deck and research note also attached on the website. We said that short term, we are bearish. But long term, in the second half of 2021, we get bullish. And for so far, that has been acting out just like that. After the earnings came out, the stock has been down, down, down. And we had previously highlighted that 170 to 175 would be the area where we believe it goes in short term. But from there, we expect a second half recovery. Given this pushback that's happening with the gaming, do you still expect that second half recovery in this stock?
It's very difficult to tell now because with this industry, game developers tend to be very secretive with their eventual timelines. So we will know for sure when we get closer to the advertised release date of GTA 5, which is the second half of this year.
Sounds good. Okay. Great stuff.
So I have another item this morning, which is just a very quick post-earnings update on Qrate Retail, QRTEA. In which the bull case was presented back in October last year. It was very non-consensus idea at the time. I know some people are still long the stock, so I thought I'd provide an update after the company reported Q4 results on Friday. They posted a significant beat on earnings, $1.59, which was more than double the consensus of 76 cents. Looking under the hood, a lot of that was driven by a 22% year-over-year increase in OIBDA for QVC, and also a more than tripling of OIBDA for Cornerstone. And then on the revenue side, sales increased 7% year-over-year to $4.45 billion versus consensus $4.36 billion. Segment-wise, QVC sales was up 16% year over year. Zulily was up 11%, and Cornerstone continues to turn the corner following its struggles in past recent years. That's now up 30% year over year. Breaking down by category, it looks like home products was the biggest driver to the upside. So we're talking about things like furnishing, culinary, and decor. However, one thing which held the company back from reporting even better numbers was consumer electronics. But this was not so much to do with demand. It was more to do with the ongoing supply chain issues and the shortage of semiconductors. So because of that, Qrate Retail wasn't able to fully meet the demand. Normally, electronics should be about 20% of their revenue, and this held them back a bit. Now, with looking at the conference call, there was some commentary that I found to be very encouraging with regards to the consumer profile. First of all, the CEO mentioned that the number of repeat purchases within 90 days is currently above the prior year performance, which is a very important metric for them because they found that whenever a customer makes a repeat purchase within 90 days, they tend to be a customer for life. Additionally, management also said that they're also seeing a greater than usual number of their newer customers getting past the 20 purchase threshold, which is another metric that accurately predicts long-term loyalty. Now, what's very interesting is that the new customers this time round, management said that they are 6 to 7 years younger on average than the existing customers. So the company is potentially penetrating on a new demographic here. And I think this is something to keep an eye on. Personally, I'm no longer in the stock just because I think there are better opportunities now that economy is beginning to reopen and the stock's up a 60% since then. So from a trading perspective, I think there are better high beta stocks to be long. But if you're more of a long-term value investor, I can definitely see some appeal here in terms of future cash generation and shareholder returns.
Yeah, very, very good quarter from this company. And just a reminder to all, right here is the video on October 12th when strong bull case, this is the writing in front of you, strong bull case for QVC, HSN, and Zulily owner QRTEA going into holiday shopping season, the valuation extremely low and 60% growth in registered customers and record free cash flow generation. This was all presented on October 12th. And if you go over here, October 12th was right over here. Okay. And so stock has done remarkably well. It was immediately starting to run very strong. Actually, this is November. So, okay, hold on a second. I messed up over here. So right here, October 12th. Okay, so you see, this is where it was presented with the stock at 6, and here we are now at 12, and it's still posting very, very strong quarter. It has done remarkably well. Well, it has run its course, in my view. I think it has, the easy money has been made as we were coming out of the pandemic, but the growth should remain strong. But this will require a long-term plan, a long-term vision, and I would, you know, be more interested in a pullback down to $10.50 to $11 per share before taking another position into this for more upside. Great stuff, Chronicle. All right, folks, we're going to stop over here a little bit longer than normal, but that's it from us. We'll see you in the chat room shortly.